Hey, hey, what's up? My name is Grab, baby. Represent this New York City thing to the fullest. Team Bang Dope Gang on deck. And this is Real Fans, Real Talk. Respect it.
Face facts, what up?
Real Fans, RealTalk.com. Where Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. Real Fans, RealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Did Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log onto the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell a Bobby sent ya from spring to winter. Tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda. Certified cosign, you know what I'm about, son. Real Fans, RealTalk.com. I'm out one. Real Fans, Real Talk. Real Fans, Real Talk. Real Fans, RealTalk.com. Real Fans, RealTalk.com. Real Fans, Real Talk. Real Fans, Real Talk. Real Fans, RealTalk.com. Real Fans, RealTalk.com.
Let me introduce my co-host, the one and only Trip Young. What's going on, Trip?
What's going on, Statman? It's bittersweet for me today. You know, the Yankees lost, and I'm still, you know, hurt by that. And I'm just emotional today, so you know, just bear with me. But you know, Ladybug is here, and she will be joining us a little bit later with some celebrity gossip. So hopefully, the laughter that she brings when she comes onto the set will, you know, get my spirits back to where they need to be.
There you go. You got something to look forward to. You don't have playoff baseball with the Yankees, but you have Ladybug later on in the program with the segment we like to call the Rumor Mill. As a little bit of a tradition, I wear my team's apparel after a loss. I did it with the Rangers. I do it with the Knicks after they're eliminated.
You do it a lot with the Knicks.
I mean, not a regular season loss.
Oh,
like,
okay,
if
right.
They're eliminated from the playoffs or something, it's, you know, kind of like a show of respect that I'm not a front runner. Right. And I support
didn't know,
my team
because
regardless.
I was saying, you got a lot of Knicks jerseys if you wear one every time, the Knicks, especially like last season.
I do have a washing machine too, you know. I don't have to have a lot of Knicks jerseys. I can have one Knicks jersey.
Saying, you know.
But nevertheless, the Yankees shut out in the loss in the wild card game, and you know, tough break for the Yankees. But I mean, this wild card system is what I have the problem with. Okay, because I think in a 5-game series, they would have been able to take the Astros, or a 7-game series. But what the 1-game wild card basically does is, you know, it only proves that you have a better ace pitcher than we do. Tanaka didn't do horrible, but at the same time, you know, the Yankees had a tough pitching matchup against them. So that's what it really came down to. Another thing I don't like about the wild card is you lose your ace pitcher going into the second round. So you're the wild card team. You don't have your ace pitcher for the first game of that the following series. Mm-hmm. And on top of that, you have the National League Central, where we saw the Cubs also getting a shutout victory, a great pitching matchup. Jake Arrieta, he had a .85 ERA against the Pirates during the season. He shut him out in this one. 4-0 against Garrett Cole, who's also another great pitcher. So Pirates, Cubs, and Cardinals, all in the National League Central, they have the 3 best records in all of baseball, and they're in the same division. So, but the Pirates and the Cubs are wild card teams. So, yeah. I mean, the way the whole wild card is structured, I think either you go back to the 4-game series that you used to have, you do at least the 3-game series because this 1-game series is just ridiculous,
yeah.
Or you go to the way football has it set up where the top 2 teams get a bye and, you know, the other 4 teams battle it out to play the teams with the bye. I mean, that's the only fair way to do it, I think, this 1-game wild card thing where you have 3 teams that have the best record in the league. You have the Cardinals who won over 100 games, which is phenomenal. You also have to think, they have the best 3 in the league, and they play each other, because they're in the same division, they play each other 20 times each in the season.
Yeah.
So, I mean, to have the Cubs and Pirates be a wild card, it's not good for the sport of baseball. Those are 2 of the top teams in the National League, and they have to battle it out in a 1-game series. to decide who moves on. So aside from the Yankees being eliminated, I was against this wild card system last year, and pretty much since it was invented, I thought it was a horrible system. But what's your take on the Yankees being eliminated and the wild card format?
Well, I'm gonna answer that, but I'm gonna take the fan mail, one of the fan mail questions as I answer that question, and that's coming from Paul from Brooklyn. Shout out to Paul in Brooklyn, because that's where we are right now. Are you guys disappointed in the Yankees? No, I'm not disappointed in the Yankees, because I do understand that Teixeira going down was a big loss for the Yankees, because it kind of took away from the 1-2 punch of him and A-Rod, because, you know, everybody saw once Teixeira went down, A-Rod's numbers started to go down as well. And we really needed that power in the lineup with Teixeira. He's having one of his best seasons in MVP season, you know, as well as A-Rod, who really, you know, bounced back from having the season suspension and whatnot. So I wasn't disappointed in the Yankees. I was actually very impressed with the Yankees, because I didn't even expect at the beginning of the season for the Yankees to be in the hunt, let alone be able to make the playoffs, you know, be it the wild card or, you know, go straight to the ALDS or whatever. So I'm not disappointed in the Yankees, but I am disappointed in the management, because I do feel like they should have made some kind of move. You know, once Toronto picked up David Price and Tulowitzki, I felt like they should have did something to kind of combat with that, because that was also when the turn happened, and then you had the Teixeira injury, you know, about that, you know, that same time. So they could have done something. And, you know, I just feel like, you know, George Steinbrenner, the real George Steinbrenner, you know, must be just turning in his grave right now, because he would have never let this go down, because his motto was, we're going to pay what we got to pay, and it's New York, I'm going to get that money back, so it doesn't matter what I spend on whoever to get them to come to the Yankees. So to answer your question and his, no, I'm not disappointed. I'm actually, you know, proud of what they accomplished this season, despite all of the injuries. I do want them to get younger. Next season, though, I think that they, you know, they're going to have to bring a couple of young hitters up into the system, and they can't spare, you know, any costs with that money. They got the money. They got the highest payroll in baseball, and they're the team that generates the most money in baseball. So there's no reason why the Yankees shouldn't go out and get a couple of young hitters to come in that lineup. Definitely need a new second baseman, because, you know, what's out there right now is not working. And then as far as the wild card goes, I agree with you. I'm not with that one game. It's not football, you know, where you get the one game.
I mean, it adds some excitement to it, but at the same time, it's not – this is baseball. It's not a true way to determine your best pitcher is better than our best pitcher, and that's all it proves. It doesn't prove that your team is better than our team.
Exactly.
So, and what you said, I mean, I'm – you know, as far as Paul's question from Brooklyn, I'm in 100% agreement with you, because – you know, no one expected the Yankees to be towards the top of the American League East. They all expected them to be towards the bottom. I mean, Jeter retired. Mariano retired. We didn't make the playoffs the past two seasons. We're back in the playoffs in the wild card. We had a good shot at winning the division, but once we lost that David Price battle, that's what it really came down to. Like, once they got David Price, that was it. You know, that's when they went on their winning streak.
And I still think if Teixeira didn't go down, we could have still maintained. Yeah, I think so too. But, you know, that the combination of the two really kind of, you know, set the Yankees back. So now we got to wait for the next season. And that's why I'm wearing the Giants hat, because I got to be in full support of the next New York team that's up.
We'll move on to the next one. But speaking of David Price, he actually lost earlier today against the Texas Rangers, so they 5-3. They take the first game of the American League Division Series in that battle. He actually becomes the first pitcher in MLB history to lose his first six starts as you know, in the postseason. So
I'm kind of glad the Yankees got the.
I mean, he's one of those people great in the regular season, bad in the postseason, I guess. Mm-hmm. But I mean, he is a good pitcher, so it's a good weapon to have come postseason time. I mean, I saw Toronto as the favorite coming out of the American League. You know, they lost the first game here, but I do see them bouncing back. What do you think as far as the American League? We have the Astros against the Royals and the Rangers against the Blue Jays. Who do you have coming out of each series, and who do you have coming out of the American League?
My Yankee-ness will not allow me to root for the Astros.
So by default, I'm just going to pick the Royals in that series. The Blue Jays were the hottest team the second half of the season. And I think that, you know, they will get it together. I do think they can beat the Rangers. But, I mean, you can't have David Price out there stinking up the joint, because that will cause them to set back. You know, you're right. There's a lot of pressure come playoff time. And that's where we separate the men from the boys, so to speak. You know, if you can't come out there and play under that pressure, you're not going to do well, and it's going to hurt the Blue Jays in the long run, because Texas is a very good team. So you go out there, if he loses, you know, another game, that could be, you know, brutal for them, because I'm pretty sure they would like to pitch him three times in the series. But, I mean, you already lost the first game, so now you got to really depend on the rotation to kind of step in and carry the load for those guys.
Yeah, I mean, another thing about the Astros that you can hate, not only did they beat the Yankees, but they were a National League team, and then now they're in the American League, and not only they haven't made the playoffs in I think like 11 years, and then they come into the American League, make the playoffs, and beat the Yankees. What does that say about the American League and the Yankees? I'm not liking that at all for the Astros, but the Royals are the heavy favorite there, and like I said, because of the wild card disadvantage, they already used their best pitcher against the Yankees. That's going to set them back a little bit. I have the Royals versus Blue Jays. Blue Jays still passing the Rangers, and Blue Jays coming out of the American League. What about as far as the National League is concerned? We got the Cubs against Cardinals. That's a historic rivalry. Cubs passing the wild card there, and the Mets and Dodgers.
Well, one, as far as the Cardinals go, I think, you know, that wild card once again is going to play a toll in that series. So I'm going to take the Cardinals in that series, not just because of the wild card. I already picked the Cardinals.
Yeah, they've won 100 games this season there.
I did just a powerhouse. And then as far as the that other series that we kind of had a little debate about, you know, last week with the other New York team, and I'm going to go back to the second fan mail question to answer this one as well. And this is coming from Randy from Queens, who writes in, the Yankees have been eliminated. Will you guys be rooting for the Mets since they are a New York team? Now, first of all, when I saw this question, I immediately thought, because after we had the whole thing with Ladybug last week and her parents, her dad was a Mets fan, so I immediately thought this was her dad writing in just to kind of throw salt on the wound.
I don't think her dad is named Randy unless
he wouldn't, you know, I think he would know. Yeah, he would use a fake name just to kind of throw salt on the wound that the Yankees are eliminated from the playoffs. But no, you know, I'm not a person that just roots for a team because they're from New York. I root for the Giants because I like the Giants and I like the Yankees, you know. And it's not even like the Mets are from Brooklyn, where I would just be like, I just throw my support behind them because they're from Brooklyn. So no, I will not be rooting for the Mets. But the other reason why I will not be rooting for the Mets is because they're playing the Dodgers, and the Dodgers are from Brooklyn, even though they're in L.A. right now. But they are from Brooklyn, playing at Ebbets Field. So anything that's from Brooklyn, I'm going to support them, even though they're out playing in L.A. right now.
I mean, the roots are from Brooklyn.
So yeah, exactly. That. So that's, hey, listen, you know, sometimes you go on the road and, you know, you got to play someplace else.
The thing that makes it hard to root for the Mets is the Mets fans. You know, when the Yankees lost, you saw the news crew out there. I saw them interviewing some of the fans and said, well, the Mets are still in there, so I guess go Mets. Like, the Yankee fans don't really have any type of hatred towards the Mets. It's the fact that the Mets are so jealous of the 27 championships that the Yankees have and how great the Yankees organization is and how miserable they are that they don't win, that they hate on us. And if the Mets do win, I don't want to hear those Mets fans trying to rub it in my face when I'm rooting for them to win because they're the other New York team. Because as much as people want to make it a rivalry, Subway Series and everything, we play each other once during the regular season, and that started in 97, I believe, because I was there at the very first Subway Series.
And you was 30 back then, so
I have the Subway Series Metro card souvenir from that game, as a matter of fact. And I went to the second game. The second game I was in the Bleacher Creatures, where a stupid Mets fan, I'm on the train with my friend, and I'm talking about we're going to get there late, so we're going to be sitting all the way in the back. Now, the tickets are sold out, So the stupid Mets fan is over there thinking, I don't have tickets already, and I'm thinking I'm going to buy tickets. But meanwhile, back then, the bleachers creatures were actually real bleachers, and it was, you first come, first serve. There was no assigned seats with the bleachers. You will sit all the way in the back if you get there late, but she's a Mets fan. She doesn't know what she's talking about. But there is no real rivalry. We don't play each other. We play each other a little bit during the regular season. We played each other in the World Series. But, you know, it's the same thing. It's the Giants-Jets is a little bit less of a rivalry because we only have the preseason, and then we'll, like, once every 4 years we'll play each other.
Do play this season.
It's not like, you know, Rangers-Islanders where that's a rivalry and you hate each other. Like, you hate the Islanders. That's probably the big New York rivalry. The Knicks and Nets, that really hasn't escalated to a rivalry because they haven't had any epic playoff battles yet or anything.
It's still new because the Nets just got here.
Rangers-Devils is a rivalry, you know, in hockey. So I'm still going to root for the Mets. The first game I went to was actually a Mets game. I was more of a Yankee fan than a Mets fan growing up, but I watched, you know, the Yankees on Channel 11 and the Mets on Channel 9. I would switch back and forth. I was a Don Mattingly fan.
Does that mean you are a better man than me? Because I will not ever.
I don't want to hear the Mets fans, like, Mets, when they win, though. Like, but I don't think that they're going to beat the Dodgers. The Dodgers, I think, are the favorite to come out of the National League. If the Mets somehow manage to beat the Dodgers, I'll have them as the favorite coming out of the National League. But I'm agreeing with you on the Cardinals.
My Yankee-ness won't allow me to even come close to saying anything that you just said right there.
Well, it is what it is. I mean, I've been a diehard Yankee fan my whole life. I do remember some of the older Mets players, Bobby Bonilla, Vince Coleman, Jeff Kent. Like, I watched them both.
You know
both.
What I remember about I the followed Mets set, both. Man? I remember them losing to the Yankees in the World Series.
I remember that, too. I remember.
So that's where it stops at right there.
I remember that, too, and I was sure enough wearing a Yankee jersey
and
during
we, you
that
know
time.
What? I got to stop you right there, Stephen, because we're doing way too much, spending too much time talking about the Mets right now, and they're winning it, and them being in the, I don't even want, let's jump over to the other New York team that's right now playing, and that's the New York Giants, who are finally back on track and doing what they're supposed to do, tied for first place right now in the NFC East, coming for the number one spot this weekend. That's what we need to be talking about right now. I can't talk about the other New York team anymore.
Okay. My dad took me to my first game, which was the Mets game, and it's his birthday coming up. So I was going to lead to say happy birthday, Dad, but Trip Young just wants to go and,
happy
you know,
birthday.
Ruin
happy that. Birthday, Papa Skevich.
And happy birthday to my older brother, Robert, whose birthday is today, and my father's is on Saturday. They're both pretty close together. So.
But they're Yankee fans.
Happy birthday. Yes, they are.
All right. So
my
better.
Dad got them for free at work. You know, right. You got to give Mets tickets away for free in order for people
I
to do it.
I turned down Mets
and
tickets.
They still don't even like.
And they
go
were good
sometimes.
Mets tickets, and I
but
turned
I was
them
young
down.
Too, so. But it was a fun day. But moving along.
Thank you.
Going to the Giants and wearing the Giants hat. It looks good on your trip. Mm-hmm. And as I said, you know, a few weeks ago, I did the Aaron Rodgers, RELAX, relax, and. Sure enough, the Giants are right back on track. The first 2 weeks of the season, they lost against some tough teams, and they had some bad breaks. But they are a legitimate contender this year. And, you know, the past 2 weeks, they won and with authority. And they're going to do the same thing this week against the 49ers on Sunday Night Football.
Yes, because the 49ers are horrible right now. There's
they lost a lot of pieces,
no
and they lost
right
their
now.
Head coach.
Kaepernick is, you know, somebody that, you know, was talked about to have so much potential and was going to be doing all of these great things for the 49ers. They would have been way better off keeping Alex Smith. Because Alex Smith, at least he wasn't turning over the ball the way that Kaepernick was, you know, once Harbaugh, I'll say, got in, actually. You know, he was actually maintaining the team. That's when they were really at their peak. But Kaepernick has regressed the past three seasons. And it's not looking like it's going to get better anytime soon. I was hoping, you know, that the matchup of Torrey Smith and Anquan Boldin again would have kind of sparked things back up for the 49ers on the offensive end. But, you know, Kaepernick is just playing so badly right now. There's nothing that they do is working, you know. I mean, this first pass the other day was a pick six. Like, it's not looking good for the 49ers at all. I think it might be time to blow that whole thing up and kind of restart. But they do play the Giants get to play them at the opportune time, and I'm looking forward to seeing that Giants offense because Ruben Randle is back. He has finally reasserted himself into that offense. Odell Beckham Jr. has been playing great. He also set the tone, another record breaker, the most yardage in the first 16 games of his career. So he is still continuing to do great things for the Giants. One of the best drafts of the Giants, you know, in a while, and he's going to continue to be great. They just finished beating up on Rex Ryan and the Bills, so you gotta love that. And Eli Manning is playing like that MVP, you know, Super Bowl MVP, two time, I might add, that he can play like. He's not turning over the football, and they're looking pretty good.
It was his first interception of the season that came in game four, so that's a huge upgrade from previous seasons.
He might have had 10 last season.
By this time last year, yeah, it was somewhere around 8 to 10 or something like that. But Rex Ryan got a firsthand look of why, you know, the Giants are the real team in New York, and he used to coach the other team in New York, which is the New York Jets, who are looking good this year, no question about that. But when you talk about quarterbacks, you know, offensive line drastically changes things, and the 49ers offensive line changed. So that's got to take some of the hit for Colin Kaepernick. But also, when you're a running quarterback, they kind of, you know, they put a spy on you. The defense adjusts. It's not, you know, you could get away with it for only so long. In his first year, you know, they didn't know what to expect from Colin Kaepernick. Now they kind of got him figured out. But also the offensive line has something to do with it. But speaking of quarterbacks, though, Matt Hasselbeck will be in on Sunday Night Football. Andrew Luck is still injured. Who do you take? They're playing the Texans tonight without Andrew Luck. What do you think the chances are of them winning?
I mean, the Texans aren't playing the best football. I mean, that whole division right now is pretty mediocre. I'm just hoping I picked up Colby Fleener in fantasy football, and he seems to have a good chemistry with Hasselbeck at that tight end position. So I'm hoping that they can kind of exploit the Texans on that end. But if I had to pick, though, I would still go with the Colts in this game. I just think that, like I said, that whole division is just weak right now. And, you know, the Texans, I don't know, man. I mean, J.J. Watt is J.J. Watt, but outside of that, I mean, Aaron Foster can't stay healthy.
Even though he scores touchdowns on offense and plays great defense, he's only one guy. You can only do so much when you need 11 out there on the field at any given time.
Now, if you can duplicate, you know, J.J. Watt and put 10 others out there just like
start the cloning process?
Yeah, then maybe, but, you know, I just don't see it. So I'm going to go with the Colts tonight.
They are saying, the experts say, 40% chance without Andrew Luck. It's really a toss-up. I'm still going to go with the Colts, too. Frank Gore is still a good weapon. Hasselbeck, you know, he's a veteran. He's, you know, he knows how to handle. It was against Jacksonville last week, but, you know, he's still not a horrible backup quarterback. So I think, you know.
It's kind of weird seeing Hasselbeck back out there. I didn't even know he was still around that because, you know, he's been in the league a long time. I'm glad he's still getting a check, though. You know, shout out to everybody that's getting a check right now. You gotta love that.
Gotta be happy for them. Somebody actually makes fun of the size of the check that you get. Well, speaking of quarterback, Ryan Tannehill going out there and making fun of the practice squad. For those that don't know the comments, after a interception on the practice squad, Ryan Tannehill, quarterback of the Miami Dolphins, said, okay, well, go ahead and enjoy your practice squad paycheck, kind of belittling practice squad guys.
See, what happens there is when, you know, if there's an injury and one of those guys has to come up and we get one of those situations where, as you like to call them, the lookout block happens because you was insulting the practice squad who has to now look out for you. You know, because they all are one unit. You know, I know it's on the defense, but they're still all one unit because all of those guys are trying to make the team. And when you take one of those hits because of the comments that you make.
Well, I mean, in a practice squad, you're kind of, you're saying if a practice
squad
no one's really risking their job by letting your quarterback get hit against the other team. But, I mean.
I mean, they're already losing. They already, you know, the coach is out of
it. Anytime you're degrading somebody, putting yourself above somebody, whether you're talking about practice squad or the general public, which is why I hated LeBron a lot after he came. I know it's a long time ago, but he came out with those comments where, you know, go back on with your regular lives and stuff, because he was a little salty after losing in the NBA Finals with his first year with the Heat. When you do things like that and you degrade other people, I got no respect for you, and that's just a ridiculous thing for him to do. When you look at it on another level, on a winning level, someone like Tom Brady actually pays his practice squad defense if they can get interception against him. So that's somebody that, you know, if you could actually intercept me, then I'm going to pay you to, you know, because it makes him better. You want to get challenged. Tannehill, inexperienced, young, just got a nice paycheck and everything, and he wants to go and belittle the practice squad guys, because, I mean, if you're throwing interceptions to practice squad guys, then there's something wrong with your game, and you need to step your game up, so.
Yeah, listen, it happens. That's why Tom Tucool is one of the elite quarterbacks, and Ryan Tannehill is playing for the Dolphins that will most likely not make it to the playoffs and won't win the Super Bowl anytime soon, so there you go.
Even make the playoffs, exactly, for that matter.
Well, especially not in that division.
Yeah, in that division, you got the Jets and the Patriots, so Jets got probably one of the wild card spots. And Patriots, they're going up against the Cowgirls, I believe, this week. Mm-hmm. And what's your take on that one?
I mean, you didn't have to ask me that question. You know what's going to happen in that game. Tom Tucool is going to throw for 300-plus yards, probably 3-4 touchdowns. The Cowgirls, you know, are going to continue to get their butts kicked like they've been doing the last 2 weeks. Even though I don't think Tony Romo is that great, he is a huge part of that Cowgirls offense. And, you know, you add on the Dez Bryant loss, of course, you know, it's the Patriots. That's, you know, might be the best team in football, you know, right now. I guess between them and the Packers, who are playing, you know, some great football as well. But, It's the New England Patriots. You don't have your starting quarterback. You don't have your top five wide receiver. There's nothing that the Cowgirls can do in this game against the Patriots.
Now, Hardy's coming back from suspension. He goes out there, talks about Tom Brady's wife, hoping that she's in the stands and hoping his sister's in the stands, and also saying...
Didn't he just get off of a domestic He's going to come out
guns blazing and...
He needs to not mention any females in any kind of statements that he makes right now, coming off that suspension for his domestic violence situation. I know he wasn't in that sense, but he needs to just keep his mouth shut and play football, be happy that he's back on the field.
He's going to be interviewed. He's going to be asked questions, and he said he's coming after Tom Brady. He's hoping that he's coming out guns blazing. Now, the media took it as guns blazing because the domestic violence and the dispute involved guns being out there in the vicinity or whatever, and they took that out of, I don't really see that big of a deal with him saying guns blazing, because that's like a metaphor for going out there, you know, full blast or whatever, but no. I think the media took that a little out of proportion. Or should he have been more conscious, sensitivity training, or not using the word guns, or what do you think?
The thing is, and this is something that, you know, we spoke about maybe a year or two ago with the whole action, with the situation with the bullying, with Pouncey and the guys out there in Miami, and we were speaking about, you know, how Kaepernick had on the hat that's, you know, and I was saying how you can, you know, support guys and not, you know, just go crazy with it and diminish your brand in the process. And when you get caught in these kind of situations and then you go out, you really have to be careful with what you say after that, because the media is going to look at anything that you say that can be deemed as, you know, in relation to your previous situation, and they're going to talk about it because it's what sells newspapers. It's what gets people on the websites watching the news. It's what brings the ratings up. It's always the negative stuff that's going to bring the ratings up. So if you have a situation where there were guns involved in your situation and your thing is, oh, guns blazing, and make sure your wife and your sister, I hope they're there and whatnot, you know the media is going to try to turn that into something else. Now, me, I do understand where he was going, but, you know, at the same time, you got to be smarter with what you say, because the target is already on your back, you know, from your previous, you know, mistakes.
I mean, getting Tom Brady riled up is not a smart thing. I mean, you got... you know, he's already got a point to prove because there's a whole Deflategate thing. And then, you know, how often is it that you got somebody to say something stupid about your wife or, you know, whatever the case may be, and you end up losing really bad because that guy played really well. Like, yeah, it happens all the time.
What the guy did to Shane Mosley's girlfriend. So at least...
I mean, because she wasn't there.
I think at least it wasn't that bad. But you don't want to give Tom Brady any extra motivation. He doesn't need any. But the fact that you're going to add on to it and give it to him, and you don't even have your starting quarterback or your best wide receiver, and you're going to be, you know, like, you need to just focus on having your you know, getting your game back to where it is, shaking the rust off, and just playing football. Don't speak to Tom Brady. You're not even on his level, bro. You're not. I'm sorry. You're not on his level. You need to just chill and play football and that, let that be the end of it, because you're not going to win this game, so.
All right. Now... just one of you, we're talking a lot of the things that that we discussed in the past in the on the rumor mill. So Ladybug is going to join us very soon, but before we do that, let me remind you guys, we are live every Thursday 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time here on BPN. Also every Tuesday, for those of you who have Verizon, it's Verizon Channel 34 in the Bronx. For those of you Bronx residents watching on Verizon. And you can also check us out on the web, realfansrealtalk.com. And also social media, facebook.com/realfansrealtalk. Twitter and Instagram at realfantalk. And without further ado, we got some more gossip news with the one and only Ladybug, ladies and gentlemen.
Hey, guys. How are you guys today? Why are you laughing, Trip?
Because you make me smile every time you come on the
set. I loved it. I love it. I love making everybody smile. That's how I do it. That's how I'm supposed to do it. But
I hope I didn't take any of your
I was just going to say, before I started, Statman was going on the rumor. He was starting a little rumor mill with the Hardy and everything.
I know, I get most of the stuff from you, but...
It's all right. You've been on it, Statman. I'm not even mad at you, but you've been on it. But as always, you know, thank you guys for having me, as always. But, you know, I got to start off with... probably, if you haven't seen it now, I'm so glad I'm the first one to tell you, because I was kind of upset earlier that's been going on. But this whole Matt Barnes and Derek Fisher incident. So for those who don't know, and for those who haven't been watching everything, if you're under a rock and you just want to watch me, I'm so happy for that. But basically... Matt Barnes is basically under a lot of heat for coming at Derek Fisher for basically messing with his ex. And now, you know, it wasn't like a secret, you know, Matt Barnes' ex, she's in social media. She was on, the Hollywood Wives, one of those reality shows. And basically he was actually, Matt Barnes was actually in a few episodes. So it wasn't like this was a secret. Yeah, the Basketball Wives of LA. And basically he was on a few episodes. So this wasn't a secret relationship. This wasn't something that was under the table. So the fact that, you know, Derek Fisher came and, you know, was messing around with her. And, you know, as we know, Matt Barnes, this is not his first time in the media for certain things. You know, this is not just a sporadic, random outburst he had. This is nothing. This is not news for people. But the fact that, you know, it kind of hit close to home because they do have children together, this was just a whole nother level. Now, I'm hearing two different stories since this is still pretty fresh. You know, I like to get my facts together, but I'll let you guys know what's up. Now, one side of the story said basically he was around and, you know, he was around the children. Derek Fisher was around the children. Now, that brings up something like, okay, you got somebody around your kids. But then another story told me that it went as far as the kids called Matt Barnes and saying, "Dad, this guy's in the house," because they have twins. So now it's to the point where, you know, we don't know, but, you know, they were interviewing Matt Barnes. They was interviewing Derek Fisher throughout the day. And, you know, they didn't want to comment on it you know, Matt, you know, he was, Barnes was just, you know, we were good friends at one point. Things happened, you know, I can't speak too much on it. And the same with Derek Fisher. So it's just very, you know, they didn't want to be on the hush-hush about it. But media always misconstrues things because they just like to get that.
That's why my first question to you is going
to
be.
Why is always.
Trip
likes to ask them questions for females?
Okay. Are you saying she smashed a homie? Or is that the
okay, but for people that don't know, people that don't know, they were homies at one point. Like, you know, you got to think of it for people that don't know. They were homies at one point.
Okay, so that's what I'm saying. Because, you know, they, you know, they're both out in L.A. for a while. Now, is her messing
Do I consider it as smashing the homies? That's you saying? You ask a ladybug if I'm...
Well, okay, then I'm going to ask you both questions. Do you consider it smashing the homie, and did she smash the homie?
I wasn't in the bed with them, so I cannot confirm nor deny what happened with the homie.
Did he have relations with that woman? That's what I'm saying.
They were spotted together in the house. That's all I'm going to say. You don't know what was happening in the house. Okay. Anything can happen behind closed doors. Okay. I wasn't there. This ladybug wasn't on that wall that day. So I don't know what happened. But I believe, you know, so I believe something is going on. Because for Matt Barnes to go off, yes, he goes off the tangent. He goes off the handle. But it had to be a trigger.
Okay.
So in my head, you know, in my head... Because I'm saying it, but in my head, I believe so.
Okay, now my next question to you is, do you consider Derek Fisher an upgrade or a step down from Matt Barnes?
Okay, but we can't say that right now because Ladybug's a different type of female. So,
well,
you know, if it was up to Ladybug, then she would have to go with Matt Barnes. I just like that type. Okay. Derek Fisher, I don't like that type. But maybe she does. Maybe she was tired of all this hoorah, hoorah.
She wanted the,
you know, the mule change. She wanted to bring herself up. She thought it was an upgrade for her.
The fact that the Knicks had the worst record in the league last year under his coaching was not a turnoff, is what you're saying.
She wasn't think about that.
Okay, that's...
She wasn't thinking about this.
Probably older, more mature, or something like
you
that.
You see? She wasn't thinking about the Knicks.
A steady job and a steady paycheck. I can understand that. Okay.
He's got a future.
He's not a...
Maybe he doesn't spend his money as recklessly or something. Who knows?
But now, because I know Derek Fisher... I didn't know Derek Fisher was single.
How close were they as friends? Because they're saying they were friends, but how close was the friendship?
Who, her and Derek Fisher?
No, but Barnes.
Oh!
Matt Barnes and Derek Fisher.
They claimed each other as friends, but it wasn't
Were they on the bowling league together or something?
They weren't even on the same team from what I can recall. Yeah. Like, I mean, Fisher was on the Lakers, Barnes was on the Clippers, so they were in the same city.
It was so in the same locker room, so they knew each other.
In the same building, but, I mean...
Weren't they both on the Lakers at one point?
I don't think so, no.
Were they at the same time? I'm not sure if they were on the Lakers at the same time. We got to look into
that. I believe they was, but I'm just saying maybe that's what it was. Maybe he's like, come on, dude, you knew she was here. You know I got kids with her. And really, like that. But somebody like that,
Exactly. Unless it's like you're really close friends, that's for males and females, unless you're like really close friends. To date somebody's ex, I don't think it's not like you're dating their exes, stealing their girl from them.
I think the problem is because it's his baby's mother. I think that's why.
And that's what I feel. And I feel like they're in such the social light.
If it's an associate, like you hung out a few times or something.
But you know what?
I think it depends on the level of the friendship.
He's probably on, you know, we both play in the NBA. You know, she was on this show, basketball.
You know, I was on the show too. You know, we were all in the public light. Now, we got kids, and
I think, because I want to go back to, you know, the whole Russell Wilson.
What do you think, Derek Fisher?
Like Future and Russell Wilson knew each other, and he was dating his baby mother. But I think this situation, since they're in the same,
it's too close to home. You know, it's too close to home.
You know, somewhat of co-workers.
Somewhat, and
it's the same sport. So I can understand where he's coming from. I'm not mad at Derek Fisher though, because she is fine, but.
Matt Barnes ran up on him. That's what it was.
Well, Derek Fisher's not about that life, though, so I don't think he was prepared for that, you know? So, you know, it is what it is. That's something that those two men are going to have to handle. Hopefully they can handle it as grown men.
So Barnes is not going to play for the Knicks anytime.
Oh, no, definitely not going to play for the Knicks.
You don't think so? Can't work it out?
You might have a stat man always. Oh, no.
In New York, you know, if that happens.
All right. What else you got for us?
Well, okay, still on the NBA tip. We know Stephen A. Smith from ESPN's First Take. Okay. He's not everybody's best friend. He's not the greatest. Everybody really doesn't give him, you know, all that just because of his information, his, you know, sources. It's always a little finicky. Now, somebody that's really not taking it is definitely Mr. Kevin Durant. He's just not taking it. Now, you know, ESPN First Take goes on, you know, throughout the day, and, you know, they have their debates, also Skip Bayless and everybody else who they have. Now, you know, Kevin Durant, basically, Smith came out on First Take and was basically discussing something about Kevin Durant, and he just lashed back and was like, no, this is not true. I don't know where you got your sources from. Nobody I didn't talk to, nobody in my team, none of my family or friends talked about it. So I don't know where you get this information. Basically, he was basically calling him a liar. Like, he was like, you know what? Whatever you're saying about me is not, you know, not true. It's not.
I think what he said that his mother said something.
Yeah, it was somebody in his immediate family.
But Stephen A. Smith went back at him, and he was saying, I didn't say directly, you know, like,
who it was, but it was somebody's
friend, and not, he didn't say that he spoke to his mother directly. He spoke to a mother's friend or something like that.
So, yeah, so.
So, he, you know. He didn't
see, Statman's on it. All right, Statman, yeah, I see you.
Ever since you've been on the show, you've been getting into the gossip.
I love it. I love it.
The flu, I got more time to look at the gossip. Stay at home.
So, you know, basically, he was just squashing all that. Like, you know what? This is not true. I don't know what you're getting your sources from. This is not what it is. So, whatever you're saying is not true. And Smith just came back, and he was like, you know, who are you to question my credentials? Who are you to question where my sources come from?
You draped them.
Yeah.
You definitely draped them, okay.
Definitely one time, once back to back. He came out, and he definitely said a statement like, you know what, you know, I do this because I have to. I really, you know, you guys are not my friends. You guys are not my family. I don't have to talk to you guys. I do it because I have to. It's a part of this business. But this is nothing that really matters to me. I don't care about this. That was from Kevin Durant. So, you know, definitely Smith, this is not his first time either. He's, like I said, he's not everyone's best friend. He's not the greatest person that, you know, he's not the first one people call to. But he has a job, and he tries to do it as best as he can. But people do question his sourcing and his, you know, credentials and things like that. So, how do you guys feel
about that Saturday Night Live clip with Stephen A. Smith where they made fun of him? And he's like, well, go, you know, I speak to, I think he was talking Kobe Bryant, making a joke like, oh, Kobe Bryant is my best friend. I speak to him every night before bedtime. Because he does say, like, he speaks to everybody.
Yeah,
he
like.
Knows everybody. Yeah. Oh, he's a very good friend of mine. He's a very good friend. But he didn't say that Kevin Durant was, you know, he got it directly for Kevin Durant or Kevin Durant's mom or whatever. So for Kevin Durant to come backlashing at him saying that, you didn't get that directly from him. You know, Stephen A. was right. He said, I didn't say I got it directly from you. I got it from somebody, you know, who knows somebody who knows somebody or something.
But
I'm riding with Stephen A. on this one, and I'm glad that he checked Kevin Durant. I'm not going to give him a pass because he signed the Rock Nation, all right? I'm not doing that, all right? I got to go with Stephen A. on this one. Man, you can't come at Stephen A. Smith like that. One, I mean, Stephen A. is doing his job. And like you said, he never said it was direct from anybody. You know, he got it from somebody, knew somebody, knew somebody, that knew somebody. Like you said, Stat, man, you can't knock the hustle. That man is doing his job. And you coming at him like that.
Wish we had the picture on deck with me and Stephen A. and exactly. Skip Bayless. Stephen A. like, Stat Man's a very good friend of mine. And got it directly from him.
Stat Man calls him every day.
So, you know,
every
that
morning on speaker while I brush my teeth.
Exactly.
One of those. So it's definitely, you know, definitely something where it's just like, wow, Kevin Durant really was just not with it. He wasn't with it, just off the rip.
He's been
just
in his feelings for a while now. And,
that too.
It's just, every time he speaks now, it just kind of gets worse and worse. He need to put them Beats headphones back on he had in the commercial and just go to sleep somewhere.
Stephen A. Smith, we love you here on Real Family. And Stephen A., I just want to say, you're the real MVP.
Ooh, I love it. But definitely so. On to the next. So now we know Mr. Gilbert Arenas definitely has been going back and forth with his ex, with this whole, you know, kicking out her and the kids, taking back the $1 million engagement ring and all this information back and forth. Now, he's basically, well, she was suing him for the whole kicking him out, you know, kicking her and the kids out, giving them no place to stay, you know, just a lot of, that's what she's suing him. Now he's countersuing. Because she was letting the social media and bloggers and, you know, she was just letting everybody know that she couldn't deal with him because he was just infested with STDs and she just couldn't take it anymore. She had to leave him and he was just low down, dirty dog, and he just wasn't right. So now he's countersuing on her, saying, girl, you know I ain't never have none of these STDs you talking about. You're falsifying information. And now he's asking for all these testing, his old medical records to back that up for his case. So it's one of these things now that it's just the drama. The drama is still adding, but it's one of these things like, really? Really? How long is this gonna go? That's how I feel. Like, with this whole back and forth, him and his ex, and it's just going on, but now it's like it's basically turned into a he said, she said. It's no definitive answers right now. He wants the definitive answers. He wants to go and say, you know what? I'm going to go get my medical records because I'm going to show you I was clean. So whatever you talking about is malarkey and I'm done with you. So,
What I'm going to say to that is, first of all, I know you guys noticed the boxing gloves on the set, and you guys know that we're big fans of boxing and supporters of boxing. You know, we're affiliated with Ring 10, the charity boxing organization. So I'm going to use the old adage in boxing, which is protect yourself at all times. I don't know if that man has those things that she says that she has, but if he does, I'm going to say this to Gilbert Arenas and to all you folks watching at home, protect yourself at all times. We don't condone that kind of behavior. I don't know if he has it, like I said, this is allegedly, that's what she says. I don't know, but I'm going to still say that, protect yourself at all times.
I mean, they're both going to ruin themselves for the future as far as whoever they date.
She's saying he gave him to her?
The dating game is going
to
mess up. Yeah, I mean.
Awkward.
And this is what I'm saying. And
both of them on the boat.
And they have kids, so we don't know. Like, this is just a he said.
He's around the paperwork with you regularly.
That's what he said. He
I got tested yesterday. It's right there. The test came back negative.
So, yeah, so.
Kind of like the Dave Chappelle scene. Where they had to sign the legal paperwork because I don't know about you, but I'm still horny.
Yo, like, it's really like that. Like,
yeah, you the documents, it's dated yesterday, the blood test came back.
And it's real, so it's definitely, but it's definitely just very unfortunate, especially for the kids, because they have kids together. So with this whole backlash, he said, she said, you know, the media likes to misconstrue, but it's one of these things where it's just getting really ugly, and you have to think about the kids. They have children together, so it's one of these things where, you know, think about them. Like, you really want to make it that messy? Because then in turn, it always goes back to the kids. The kids go to school. These kids have friends. These kids have people. And they know who their parents are.
And we lose sight of that. Now, you know, all jokes aside, though, a lot of times we lose sight, you know, especially in these situations when there are kids involved. And now, listen, if you want to kick her out the house, I don't even care. You can do that. She's a grown woman. She can take care of herself. You're an adult. You should be able to take care of yourself. But if that's true, you know, with the kids and kicking the kids out, too, you need to be ashamed of yourself for that, all right? You know, but keep in mind, and this is not just for Gilbert Arenas and his wife or, you know, whatever. This is just in general, you know, parents. You got to always keep in mind that your decisions affect your children, all right? So you don't want this back and forth or, you know, whatever's going on to play a toll in their lives because, like you said, they go to school. They go to the park, and then even when they're at home, they got to deal with this stuff. They go online. You can't miss this stuff. You know, Ladybug isn't the only person that can go online and search this stuff up. They go online. They have famous parents. You go online, search your father's name, and what comes up? he gave mommy an STD. She kicked mommy out the house. She did this, and that's what they're going to be saying. So you're going to mess these kids up.
And you got other people. Like, you don't know who's messaging them. They probably have social media accounts, and they just want to be regular kids or teenagers or whatever. You probably have all this, oh, your mom is I, your dad is I.
Like, cyberbullying comes into
this cyberbullying. And just because your parents are fortunate or just because they're in the light doesn't take away from the fact that it happens. Yep. So it's one of these things where I just hope that this mess gets cleared up. Nobody wants to hear that somebody you've been with has something or could have possibly had something. That's just something too serious to play around with. So at this point, it's something where I'm just like, you know what? Just let the he said, she said, go somewhere and just...
Be adults.
Yes.
That's what you should do. Be That's adults. It. Be mature. Handle your business in-house. There's no reason for you to put your business out there for the world to gawk at, to judge you, to use it against you down the road. You know what I mean? If you got a problem, handle it in the house. At the end of the day, at one point, you loved each other, your family, you got kids. Think about your kids and what all of this is doing to your kids.
Even if you're not famous, I mean, you see normal couples who just, like, you know, they, you know, try to use the kids as to hurt each other. And, you know, they'll tell the kids, oh, mommy doesn't, you know, mommy did this because she doesn't love you, or daddy did this because he doesn't love you. And, like, what are you doing? Like, you know... Who really wins in that? It's just, you know, ridiculous, but a lot of people aren't conscious of those things. So.
Exactly. So with that, you know, just going to, couple of more, you know, Ladybug got a little stuff in the bag. You know, I like to go on my bag. I like to go on my bag. It's all right. But
we did shot for shot today. We just end up in a tie.
I think that's what it is now. Shot for shot makes, you know, Ladybug makes you guys. I think I'm too fair. I think I had to do my sports research. I'm like, no, you're wrong. That's what they want to see soon. It's all right.
You said that, though.
What? Because I'm just saying.
Wrong. That's
That's why I'm still the back-to-back champion.
Anyway, let me talk about somebody pleading.
So I won the last two.
Oh, so you see how it go? Well, you see how they argue, guys? Mr.
Total
Sylvester
record,
Stallone.
I have 132 wins. You have 96. I just made those numbers
exactly.
up.
You see?
Because I'm still the king of shot for shot.
But let's talk about Mr. Stallone, definitely defending Mr. Chip Kelly of the Eagles. You know, Rocky's a diehard, you know, Eagles fan, and he's trying to tell him to.
Philadelphia, running up the stairs in the Philadelphia.
And that's what it is. So, you know.
Even though it was, you know, motivated by the Bayonne leader, but, you know.
Exactly. But, you know, he's definitely, you know, telling the fans, like, come on, stick with it, guys. We got this. You know, Kelly got this. So, you know, Stallone's definitely trying to keep the Eagles in the. Well, and Kelly alive.
It's called a biased, blind fan, pretty much. That's, you know.
That's how you feel?
Shout out to Sylvester Stallone, because I'm actually am looking forward to the new Rocky movie or Creed or whatever coming out soon. So shout out to him for that. And, I, you know, I'm not mad at Stallone because he's trying to support his team. I don't feel bad. I do feel bad, though, for our technical director, Cliff, because he is a fan. And I know every week he sits back there behind the boards. And it's after the Eagles lose yet another game and go another year without a Super Bowl win. And I feel bad for him.
But Stallone got your back, Cliff. Stallone got your back. You see?
All the losses he's been there, so we got to appreciate that.
Exactly.
You know?
That's why he's the best technical director.
Awesome.
In the business, yeah.
Exactly.
But you know? Definitely another, well, it was a somewhat positive because the NFL made a full month without any arrest until the Titans rookie wide receiver got arrested for speeding.
It was actually the longest period of time the NFL went without arrest since 2012, I believe. Mm-hmm.
See, Statman? Come on, Statman. I love it. I'm loving it. I'm loving this feedback. I love it. But, yeah, you know, it was a positive until, you know, he got arrested in Missouri. So it was all right. NFL, y'all did it. Y'all did it.
Good just a week ago.
It was all good.
You had to be that guy, right? You just had to be that guy.
I had to be the rookie, though. I feel bad. I had to be the rookie, though. It's all right.
The fact that he got Beckham, you know, in his name, just
it does. But that's definitely my reel for the week. And, you know, I love to bring more reel every week. I love it.
Well, we definitely appreciate the lady. Well, I tell you, the week. goes by slow, but when we get here, you definitely turn up, and we love having you here.
Thank you.
Well, with that being said, it's about that time for the final thoughts segment of the program. Ladybug, do you have any final thoughts you want to add?
All I want to say is that, as always, I hope things work out for the positive. I'm so excited. I'm so happy football season's coming because it's good food in my house. And
thanks for the invite.
Yeah, you guys could come. You know, yeah, but anyway,
you got it on camera.
You can watch it on the archive. It's all right.
Show up to your house. What are you guys doing here? You guys.
It's all right. So yeah, it's cool. And then shout outs to my dad because you know he is the Mets fan. I'm sorry, Trip, but I got to shout out dad this week. Shout out to dad this week. My mom got last week. Shout out my dad this week.
We know you sent that fan mail question. We know it.
We know you're not Randy's. Trip Young, your final thought of the evening?
Oh, man, listen, you see where I'm at with mine. You see how I came in today, right? Let's go Giants, man. We need another one. Let's push it up to 3-2 on the week, man, you know, and we're going to have a lot of fun this week in football. See, oh, you know what? Shout out because it's homecoming weekend at LIU, so I'm going to be up there this weekend, you know, showing off and reminiscing. I'm gonna love that, so shout out to LIU.
CW Post, definitely a fun time over there for homecoming. I'm going to go with the final thought out there to the MLB to change that wild card rule, make it a 3-game series, make it a 5-game series, make it 6 teams, do something, because the 1-game, 5-teams thing is just ridiculous. Don't agree with it at all, but with that being said, make sure you like us on Facebook, facebook.com/realfansrealtalk. Twitter and Instagram at Real Fan Talk. All our information, individual contact information, archived episodes, everything all on one website, realfansrealtalk.com. Make sure you check it out. And we'll see you next week, same time, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on BPN. And for Ladybug, Trip Young, I'm Mark the Statman Skevich. Thank you for joining us on this edition of Real Fans Real Talk. And we'll see you next time, everyone.
Good night.
Face facts, what up? RealFansRealTalk.com. With Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend the CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. RealFansRealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Did Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log onto the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell him Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter. Tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda. Certified.